morning, brothers and sisters in Christ. Welcome to our Wednesday morning devotion. We pray that our devotion will bring you some solace, reassure your faith, strengthen you as we press forward together to face the uncertain times ahead. Our readings for today are Ezekiel 11, 14 to 25, Hebrews 7, 1 to 17, Luke 10, 17 to 24. Our opening sentence is on page 34. Spirit within you, and make you follow my statutes, and be careful to observe my ordinances. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Blessed be the Lord our God, by whose grace we are yet alive. Blessed be his Son, Jesus Christ, by whose rising we are set free. Blessed be the Spirit of God, in whom is our hope and our joy. Father, we come together in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, to offer your worship, praise, and thanksgiving. To you belong all power and glory. You are the source of all goodness. Let our worship bear witness to your peace and saving power through your Spirit. May we ever rejoice in the abiding presence of our risen and ascended Lord. Amen. The Jubilate, Psalm 100. O shout to the Lord in triumph, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness, and come before his face with songs of joy. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who has made us, and we are his. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. Come into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and bless his holy name. For the Lord is good. His loving mercy is forever. His faithfulness throughout all generations. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. And now we approach God's throne of mercy, seeking His forgiveness for those things which we should not, for doing those things that we should not have, and not doing those things that we should have. We bring to Him even those issues of which our consciences are afraid. Lord, we pray for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone, and so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in the newness of life, through to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Set us free, O God, from the bondage of our sins, and give us the liberty of that abundant life which you have made known to us in your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Psalms are 101 and verses from Psalm 109. Psalm 101. I will sing of mercy and justice. To you, O Lord, will I sing praises. I will strive to follow a blameless course. O, when will you come to me? I will walk with sincerity of heart within my house. I will set no worthless thing before my eyes. I hate the doers of evil deeds. They shall not remain with me. A crooked heart shall be far from me. I will not know evil. Those who in secret slander their neighbors, I will destroy. Those who have a haughty look and a proud heart, I cannot abide. My eyes are upon the faithful in the land, that they may dwell with me. And only those who lead a blameless life shall be my servant. Those who act deceitfully will not dwell in my house, and those who tell lies shall not continue in my sight. I will soon destroy all the wicked in the land, that I may root out all evildoers from the city of the Lord. We go to Psalm 109, verses 1 to 4 and 20 to 30. Hold not your tongue, O God of my praise, for the mouth of the wicked, the mouth of the deceitful is open against me. They speak to me with lying tongue. They encompass me with hateful words and fight against me without a cause. Despite my love, they accuse me, but as for me, I pray for them. They repay evil for good and hatred for my love. But you, O Lord, my God, O deal with me according to your name. For your tender mercy's sake, deliver me. For I am poor and needy, and my heart is wounded within me. I have faded away like a shadow when it lengthens. I am shaken off like a locust. My knees are weak through fasting, and my flesh is wasted and gaunt. I have become a reproach to them. They see and shake their heads. Help me, O Lord my God. Save me for your mercy's sake. Let them know that this is your hand, that you, O Lord, have done it. They may curse, but you will bless. Let those who rise up against me be put to shame, and your servants will rejoice. Let my accusers be clothed with disgrace and wrap themselves in their shame as in a cloak. I will give thanks to the Lord with all my mouth. In the midst of the multitude will I praise him, because he stands at the right hand of the needy, to serve his life, to save his life from those who would condemn him. Glory to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Our first reading is from the book of Ezekiel, chapter 11, beginning at verse 14 and unto 25. Then the word of the Lord came to me, "Mortal, your kinfolk, your own kin, your fellow exiles, the whole house of Israel, all of them, and those whom the inhabitants of Jerusalem have said, they have gone far from the Lord. To us this land is given for possession. Therefore say, thus says the Lord God, do I remove from them far away among the nations, and do I scatter them among the countries? Yet I have been a sanctuary to them for a little while in the countries where they have gone. Therefore say, thus says the Lord God, I will gather you from the peoples and assemble you out of the countries where you have been scattered, and I will give you the land of Israel. When they come there, they will remove from it all its detestable things and all its abominations. I will give them one heart and put a new spirit within them. I will remove the heart of stone from their flesh and give them a heart of flesh, so that they may follow my statutes and keep my ordinances and obey them. Then they shall be my people, and I will be their God. But as for those whose heart goes after detestable things and their abominations, I will bring their deeds upon their own head, says the Lord God. Then the cherubims lift up their wings, and the wheels beside them, and the glory of God of Israel was above them. And the glory of the Lord ascended from the middle of the city, and stopped on the mountain east of the city. The Spirit lifted me up, and brought me in a vision by the Spirit of God into Chaldea, to the exiles. Then the vision that I have seen left me, and I told the exiles all the things that the Lord had shown me." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. We continue as we pray the Benedictus on page 40 of your Book of Common Prayer. Blessed are you, Lord God of Israel. You have come to your people and set them free. You have raised up for us a mighty Savior, born of the house of your servant David. Through your holy prophets, you promised of old to save us from our enemies, from the hands of all that hate us, to show mercy to our forebears, and to remember your holy covenant. This was the oath you swore to our father Abraham, to set us free from the hands of our enemies, free to worship you without fear, holy and righteous before you all the days of our life. A new child shall be called a prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare the way, to give God's people knowledge of salvation by the forgiveness of their sins. In the tender compassion of our God, the dawn from on high shall break upon us, to shine upon those who dwell in darkness and the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. A reading from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 10, beginning at verse 17 and unto 25. The 70 returned with joy, saying, "Lord, in your name, even the demons submit to us." He said to them, "I watched Satan fall from heaven like a flash of lightning. See, I have given you authority to tread on snakes and scorpions and over all the powers of the enemy, and nothing will hurt you. Nevertheless, do not rejoice at this, that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven. At that same hour, Jesus rejoiced in the Holy Spirit and said, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent and have revealed them to infants. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows who the Son is except the Father, or who the Father is except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Then turning to the disciples, Jesus said to them privately, Blessed are the eyes that see what you see, for I tell you that many prophets and kings desire to see what you see, but did not see it, and to hear what you hear, but did not hear it. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. And now, brothers and sisters, I thank you for the privilege of sharing my thoughts with you on this morning's gospel reading. I do so in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The book of Ecclesiastes tells us that for everything there's a season and a time for every purpose or every matter under heaven. As we follow the life and times of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we would observe that he was never timid to give expression to his emotions. He gave meaning to the life and times. He gave meaning to the times that he was going through by revealing his emotions. We recall how when he saw Jerusalem, that he wept. Luke 9:41. Again, he was greatly disturbed in spirit when he saw Martha weeping at the grave of Lazarus. And when he actually saw the grave of Lazarus, he too wept. We saw that he was annoyed to the extent that he overturned the tables of the money changers and the seat of those who sold doves in the temple of Jerusalem, because they were making God's house a den of thieves. Yet again, Jesus displayed compassion for the widow of Nain over the loss of her only son. And he was amazed at the faith of the centurion over the love of his servant. And so, in our gospel passage today, we read how Jesus rejoiced upon the return of the 70. These emotional expressions of Jesus was intended to show that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ was human, and it displayed how humane he was, how humane the Son of God, the Most High God, was when he walked the earth. But unfortunately, success and power sometimes render us devoid of emotion and expression, especially occasioned by the misfortune of others. But I was reminded by my 7-year-old grandson recently that everyone has feelings, and we need to show that we care. But Jesus always showed his feelings, and we should take note of that and act the same. The 72 or 70 returned from their first mission, elated that in the name of their master, the demons had submitted to them through his power working through them. Initially, they may have been pleasantly surprised that the demons submitted to them. But they should have known that they had no power of their own. and that they should not have been, and it would have been only through the power of God, and that God had used them for his purpose, and that should have been their joy. As Christians, we must not cease to be careful with success. Success in ministry or in any other way. Because with success, it comes cloaked the danger of pride and the myriad of other false notions about ourselves. But Jesus shared in the joy of his apostle, of his disciples. And to let them know, as he said, I will be with you always. And he said, I watched Satan fall from heaven like a flash of lightning. The success of the disciples bared testimony to the weakening of Satan's stronghold and the weakening of his kingdom. It was a foreshadowing of the eventual total destruction when, at the end, our Lord will rule completely over the world, ending the terror and the ruler of this world. Jesus reminded the disciples that it was only through the power which he had given them that they were able to do so much good against the evil, against the enemy, without themselves being hurt. The Lord granted the disciples authority over the forces of darkness, and they were immune from harm during their mission. As faithful servants of God, they were protected. You see, the protection of God is continuously with his servants. It is Jesus who said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. So Jesus told the apostles that although there was cause for joy, it should not be on account of the submission of the spirits to them, but because of their salvation, their names being written in heaven. My dear friends, God grants his salvation to the humble, to the lowly. Those who think that they have earned their salvation on account of their own deeds or their own self-righteousness and actions, they have already received their reward. This is as Jesus guided us in Matthew 6:2, where he warned us to be careful about acts of righteousness before men. In spite of his sobering of the disciples, the scripture said, at the same hour, Jesus rejoiced in the spirit. His rejoicing may have had little to do with what was accomplished by the disciples, those he sent out. As he revealed in his prayer to the Father, he thanked the Father. And in the expression of this joy, it was firstly because the Father had concealed from the intellectuals of the day the very heavenly things he revealed to the lowly disciples and those considered infants where their intellect was concerned. And yet, being an infant is not without its merit. The disciples may not have been among the scholarly class of the day, but they were infants with faith, devotion, and obedience. Their intellectuals are always too wise, too knowing, and too proud to have that level of faith. These were the things which blinded them from the truth concerning the Son of God. The Son of God that was there in their presence. It was through these infants, the less educated, that Jesus worked most effectively. The Lord rejoiced for those the Father had given him, through whom so much good was achieved. and also for the revelation of the eventual downfall of Satan. And all of that was through the gracious will of the Father. This too was cause for Jesus to rejoice in the Spirit, because he acted in compliance with the will of his Father. He acted in compliance with God, God the Father. As Jesus continued his discourse with the disciples, he enlightened them concerning his absolute power granted to him by his Father, saying, "All things have been handed over to me by the Father." Also, the identity of the Father is known only to him, and the total truth about him is known only by the Father. Even the identity of his, even his own identity was known only to those the Son chose to reveal his identity to. For example, to Peter in Matthew 16:17, when Peter confessed his name. To some extent, to Nicodemus. To some extent also, to Legion in Mark 5:7. Of course, to the 12 apostles. And then to the criminal on the cross in Luke 23:40-43. In all these revelations, we sense that the announcement was informed only by the favor of God, because Jesus chose to reveal himself to them. The fact is, God is beyond human understanding. As Job 11:7-12 reveals. But the Son of God knows him perfectly. Finally, Jesus privately said to his disciples, "Blessed are the eyes that see what you see." This profound statement of Jesus was to enlighten the disciples of their very privileged existence. They were there at the time when God in the form of man, the very Son of God, walked with them. They were specially privileged to have him as their personal friend and teacher, counselor and guide. They were privileged to see the miracles and to hear his teachings firsthand. As Jesus explained what they experienced being with him, kings and prophets desired as much, but were unable to. My friends, the disciples were indeed privileged to have the kingdom of God come near. We too are privileged that we can explore God's living word and to be guided by its truth. For this, we ought to be joyful. We must know, however, to be joyful with humility and trusting as infants do. For joy could be tainted with the sin of self-righteousness. Our greatest joy then must be that through our Lord Jesus Christ, we are favored with having our names written in heaven, simply by believing in him and confessing his holy name. May the Lord be with you. Let us now confess our faith as we say together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. By way of intercession, we continue in our prayers for our world and for our country, gripped in this pandemic that simply will not let up, to the point that drastic measures have to be taken to bring an end to the suffering and the deaths we experience. But we pray that God in His mercy will put His hand and assist us in dealing with this situation. Lord, in your mercy, please hear our prayer. We continue to pray for the Anglican Church worldwide, for the well-being of the Archbishop of Canterbury, the Most Reverend Justin Welby. We pray for our provincial Archbishop, the Most Reverend Howard Gregory, for the Diocesan Bishop, the Right Reverend Claude Berkeley. We pray for the retired bishops, Calvin, Roll, and Clive, and God will strengthen them to continue to be good shepherds of His people. In our Diocesan cycle of prayer, today we pray for St. Barnabas Pleasantville. We pray for the Reverend Canon Steve West, Archdeacon Emeritus. We also pray for fellowship and vocation. In our parish, we continue to pray for our parish priest, Reverend Father Dr. Anderson Maxwell. We pray for his assistant, Reverend Father Titus Akrali, for the deacons, Reverends Finley, Fanfe, and Pontifleck. We pray also for the laity, remembering our former rector, Canon Gemmott Hazelwood. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Remember today, and we bring before our Father, the five congregations of our parish, at Oropoon, at St. Philip's, the Church of the Transfiguration, St. Aidan's, and St. Mary's, remembering the sick, praying that God will bless them and that they will make good use of their time drawing closer to Him. Lord, in your mercy, please hear our prayer. We continue to pray for the well-being of our citizens abroad, hoping that under all the circumstances, that they will return to us soon, and that they will be kept well wherever they are. We continue to pray that the Lord would have mercy on the souls of those who have passed, and that He will grant them His rest. As we continue in prayer, we'd pray together, Suffrage C on page 44 of your Book of Common Prayer. Save your people, Lord, and bless your inheritance. Govern and uphold them now and always. Day by day we bless you. We praise your name forever. Lord, keep us from all sin today. Have mercy on us, Lord, have mercy. Lord, show us your love and mercy, for we have put our trust in you. In you, Lord, is our hope, and we shall not hope in vain. Our colic is for the seventh Sunday of Easter. Found on page 177. We pray together the collect for the seventh Sunday of Easter on page 171 of your Book of Common Prayer. Let us pray. O God, the King of Glory, you have exalted your only Son, Jesus Christ, with great triumph to your kingdom in heaven. Do not leave us comfortless, but send your Holy Spirit to strengthen us and to exalt us to that place where our Savior Christ has gone before, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, in glory everlasting. Amen. We continue on page 45. Into your hands, Lord, we commend ourselves this day. Let your presence breathe us this close. Strengthen us to remember that in whatever good works we do, we are serving you. Give us a diligent and watchful spirit, that we may seek in everything to know your will, and knowing it, may gladly perform it, to the honor and the glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The prayer of dedication. Almighty God, we thank you for the gift of your holy word. May it be a lantern to our feet, a light to our path, and a strength to our lives. Please take us and use us to love and serve all persons in the power of the Holy Spirit and in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Now, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us evermore. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. And now, my brothers and sisters, our service has come to an end for this morning. We pray that God will comfort you as we go through this period, and that we adhere to the advice and the counseling of those who are set in place to govern over us. This is the only way that we can deal with the situation at this time. Let's now go in peace and serve the Lord in the name of Christ.